It's the Dale and Dale show. As we come off of turn four, you know who I'm pulling for. It's Dale Jarrett. Bring her at the inside, Dale. Don't let him get down there. He's going to make it. Dale Jarrett's going to win the Daytona 500.
And it makes me feel good that people say that they still get that tape out and play it and still get tears in their eyes. And that makes me feel good. And most of the time it is dads who are saying that, and because they can relate to it. You know, we've all had moments with our children. I just happen to have a bigger moment than most people are able to experience.
The joy of watching a father call his son home to victory. Feeling the pain as a father loses his sons at much too young an age. The thrill when chances taken and calculations made prove to be correct.
Ricky Rudd wins the fourth Brickyard 400 in Indianapolis.
When the brotherhood forged by long hours of preparation meet the perfect opportunity. The NASCAR story is more than horsepower and metal. It's more than dollars and asphalt. It's a story that touches the deepest fabric that binds America together. It's about family.
NASCAR has captured the imagination of sports people all across the country. A lot of it has to do with the quality of the people involved. The fact that they're down to earth, you don't have a lot of big shot, high profile guys that don't know how to handle the adulation of the crowd. These men never have forgotten how they got to be famous. And they got there because of not only their own courage and dedication, but because their fame also comes from the dedication of their fans. And I think part of it is because people can identify with the people involved in the sport. Incidentally, not just those driving the cars, those in the pits, whatever else it is. And so it has a grassroots quality to it that has captured the imagination of the American people all across the country. It's not just the South.
The story of the first 50 years of NASCAR is about an extended family of competitors, teams, and fans. It's about passion and loyalty towards a sport that is hard to explain. Some have referred to it as an addiction, as a love too deep to walk away from, even when the sport tries to throw devastating blows your way.
Really, it's a great big family. NASCAR is a big collage of different people that work hard and race hard and enjoy what they're doing together, and all of us can't be winners, but all of us are part of the winning, part of the mix. And it's what we do. It's what NASCAR is about. It's racing.
In stick and ball sports, heritage is normally passed on institutionally, from Pop Warner to high schools to the collegiate level and then to the NFL if you're good enough. Racing enjoys no similar structure, so the torch is often passed through generations by family. Racers are often sons of racers, and those who come in from the outside, they are warmly embraced as new converts to the NASCAR way of life and made part of the extended family.
To see your children accomplish things means a lot more than anything that you ever do yourself. And so to see him finally get in position to win, to be a contender, week in and week out, that's all he ever wanted. That's what he worked for all of his life, to get in that position. And I knew that. I saw the hardships that he went through, saw the sacrifices that he had to make to get to where he is today. And then to see those rewards coming, that just means so much.
When the France family gathered, it's hard to imagine how eclectic the conversation might be. In spite of being a $2 billion a year industry, NASCAR is still a family-owned business. One family for 50 years. Each generation was free to leave its own unique set of fingerprints on the family property.
I don't spend too much time thinking about, well, now how would he have done it? I think more from a personal standpoint that you'll see a picture or something to remind you. Just someone will mention his name, and that'll get you thinking about something, you know. But he was, I wouldn't be sitting where I am now and, without what he did, and neither would a lot of people be sitting where they're sitting.
When the time is right, the reins will be passed again. Grandchildren of the founder stand ready to make their mark with a strong sense of their ancestry.
The biggest advice I give to them is to try and work together as a team, as Bill and I have, and as Mom and Dad did. I think that's the success that we've had has been a result of a team effort, and they have to carry on that tradition.
I think NASCAR's long-term future is to not lose sight of some of the things that got us here, and at the same time adopt some strategies that have worked in other places. So if we do those two things, I think we're gonna be in great shape.
I think my earliest memories were more focused around the business and working in the ticket office with my grandmother. She was very disciplined, probably one of the most disciplined people that I know. She counted everything. She knew how much gas she put in her car the last time she filled it up. She counted every dollar that went through the ticket office. My grandfather was the polar opposite, and I think that anyone that knew Bill Sr. would remember how much charisma he had. I remember that from very early on. He was outstanding in that way, and he was always entertaining. He always had a group of people around of him.
In early 1992, Anne France passed away while Bill Sr. would succumb to a long battle with Alzheimer's just a few months later in June. Some of his final comments during a visit with the Reverend Hal Marchman put everyone at peace.
He said, not going to be too long before you're going to have to say something about me. He said, be sure and tell God I'm one of his friends.
The founders of NASCAR had passed, but their place in history is secure. With the unveiling of the statue that now stands in front of Daytona, USA, Bill France had reason for optimism.
And Lisa Bruce's son, Ben Kennedy, the first of the fourth generation, who is too young today, but in the future will ask, who were they? What did they do? And most importantly, how did they do it?
We've had the opportunity to take my son Ben into the RV area on the weekends. A lot of times we'll go in there and spend some time with the competitors and their young families, and it's given us a chance to see what they go through week in and week out, and trying to balance both the family and the business.
Got Ben up here now because I think he'll be one. I'm looking forward to standing here 50 years from now.
The starting lineup is posted for the 50th Daytona 500 in the year 2008. It's a pretty safe bet the lineup will include names like Petty, Bodine, Jarrett, and Earnhardt. But the first names may be different. It could be Adam Petty, Barry Bodine, Jason Jarrett, or Dale Earnhardt Jr. pacing the field.
I don't really know what makes families follow what their dads do. It's just, is in racing, it was just when my growing up around my dad, we went to the races with my dad and my mom. It was a family opportunity, family outing. And when course, I've raced over the years, Dale Jr. and Kelly and Taylor. She goes everywhere we go, pretty much. It's just a family-oriented thing. We all go and do it together.
The branches of the NASCAR family tree has many limbs, with a root system that extends to the very first strictly stock car race in 1949, which included a father and son, as well as three Flock brothers.
This is the famous team of the Flock brothers. I guess you'd call us famous.
Well, that's what I hear. They tell me you're a pretty famous outfit.
Thank you, sir.
This is what?
Bob.
And Tim.
And Bonnie.
Bonnie.
That's right.
They tell me that this whole family of Flocks is a great bunch of racers and busy and all kinds of things that furnishes people with thrills. Is that right?
Well, we try to, yes, sir.
Said that your sister was a driver at one time and another sister was a parachute jumper.
That's right, sir.
Well, what's your mother think about all this?
Well, my mother's got gray hair.
Well, I don't wonder. Well, I certainly would like to.
My mother's incident, and she's here.
Oh, she's here.
Come here, Mom.
Oh, come in here, Mother.
That's right.
What do you think about all this?
Oh, I think they're wonderful.
Do you?
Yeah, I just keep my fingers crossed.
Big Mama understood her son's love for the sport, but also allowed her daughter Ethel to compete. In those days, it wasn't considered just a man's sport.
Mrs. Barbara Gamachi of Long Island makes up for lost time and goes back to her favorite sport, stock car racing. The 23-year-old housewife, whose husband is also a jalopy jockey, says racing is such a change from housework, a bit more exciting, end of quote. 11A is her number. Sinner and kids are eager spectators as stock car mama gives Papa and the other male drivers a run for the money. Ricky roots for his daring mom, whose stock goes up with every race.
No NASCAR Winston Cup starts are listed for Mrs. Gamachi, so she didn't join Ethel Flock Mobley, Sarah Christian, and Louise Smith as one of the few pioneer women drivers during the birth of the sport. Although that trio blazed an early trail with a total of 20 starts among them, it would be a quarter century before another female racer would have an impact on the sport.
Coming from a position where all the top drivers were saying, well, we don't have to worry, she's not going to make the field. Oh, she made the field. Well, we don't have to worry, she'll be all worn out in 15 laps and climb out of her car and give it to somebody else. Ha, fat chance.
It was a man's world and the drivers didn't want a woman around. Certainly not one that might could beat them on the racetrack, but she went the distance and really did well.
Janet would race a total of 33 times, posting 5 top 10 finishes. But no one has picked up on her lead to try to compete on a consistent basis in NASCAR's Elite Series. But if there were a fountain of youth, Louise Smith would like one more shot.
Ooh, I would fly in there on roller skates. I would be so happy, because all that money out there flashing now, I would be flying out there.
If women drivers have been in the minority, so have people of color, perhaps a reflection of the American culture of the day. Charlie Scott was the first African-American to compete, driving for Carl Kiekhafer on the beach in 1956. 5 years later, another Scott, Wendell, though not related, would begin a career that would span 13 seasons and 495 starts. His win at Jacksonville, Florida in 1964 remains the only time an African-American driver has visited Victory Lane. His life was portrayed in a Hollywood movie, Greased Lightning, and although he passed away in 1990, he is still revered in his hometown of Danville, Virginia as a real NASCAR hero. But once again, no driver of color has tried to compete consistently since his retirement. In a country that is fascinated with underdogs, the NASCAR family has always been flavored with men willing to fight the odds and race for the pure love of the competition.
I never forget it. Well, I mean, the people looked like monkeys climbed up on the fence. I mean, they was climbing all over the place, squealing and hollering. You could hear them in the race car, you know. And that's the first time I ever had that, and the last time I ever had that. But it everywhere you went, it just everybody was just all pumped up, carried away. Got home, I come home, and some friends here had strung a big banner across the service station on the fence, and I just, it was unreal.
Buddy Arrington was describing his most unforgettable race in a career that had 560 starts. On that day in Talladega, he finished third. Entering his 30th year of competition in 1998, the epitome of the independent driver today is wing-tipped 57-year-old Dave Marcus. Second in all-time starts with 835, Marcus can claim five victories. Fans admire and respect his spirit and his will to continue to compete.
Daddy, start your engine!
The only driver with more starts than Marcus is Richard Petty, whose family ties go back to the very first NASCAR race.
I would say from Richard Petty's standpoint, he's lived a charmed life. To be born to Lee Petty and Elizabeth Petty in the racing business, and then be able to fall in and follow in your father's footsteps, to doing something that you wanted to do, that you liked to do. You didn't have to look for a hobby. You didn't have to look for vacations. You didn't have to look for nothing. Everything was right in front of you. Everything that you ever wanted to do, everything you wanted to accomplish, you might not accomplish it all, but you accomplished a big portion of it.
With 1,177 starts spanning 35 years, Richard Petty spent many nights on the road. But his return home was not always met with enthusiasm, as Kyle Petty related during his father's 1997 induction into the International Motorsports Hall of Fame.
But you always knew when Richard Petty was coming home because my mama would cook a big old pot of pinto beans because that was his favorite meal. So we had pinto beans. I hate pinto beans. I'll tell y'all that.
Early in life, a pot of beans may have been a gourmet meal for the driver third on the list of all-time starts, Bobby Allison. He learned grit and determination from a strong-willed mother that gave birth to 13 children.
My mom would be 91 years old the day of the race here at Talladega. And she still drives her own car. And she hates somebody that mopes away from a traffic light.
So if a strong will is an inherited trait, it has certainly been passed from Catherine Allison to her sons as they face the sternest test of any members of the NASCAR family.
Davey Allison trying the inside move. Bobby Allison holds him off. They come to the stripe, and the winner of the 30th annual Great American Race, Bobby Allison. Davey Allison, his son, in second. Judy Allison ecstatic. What a tremendous family performance. The Alabama gang has conquered the Daytona 500 in its 30th running.
It was the perfect finish. In the bright sunshine of Daytona, the Alabama gang was on a pedestal. The state's favorite father edging his son in stock car racing's biggest event. But for many who loved the gang, it may have been their last real opportunity to smile.
The Alabama gang really came about because Bobby and myself and Red Farmer, we traveled together everywhere we went. The three guys, Bobby with a pickup truck, me with a pickup truck, and Red with a station wagon. And at the time that the Alabama gang was really born, we would run four or five times a week. And we'd go to a town or something, and I don't really know who actually started it, who actually was the first one to say, well, here comes the Alabama gang. We didn't feel like we were a gang, but we were going to try to take all their money.
The gang would later include their close friend Neil Bonnet and Bobby's sons, Davey and Clifford. Next to the Crimson Tide, no group was more loved and revered in the heart of Dixie. Bobby Allison made his first mark nationally in the NASCAR Modified Series, winning national championships in 1964 and 1965. Red Farmer's racing heritage is nearly the age of NASCAR itself, winning national NASCAR Sportsman Championships in 1969, 70, and 71. He is said to have won more than 700 races.
When he got time to race, he was the most competitive person I ever raced against. I'm saying a lot because I raced against a lot of people.
Donnie was the younger of the Allison brothers. He made the greatest splash of any NASCAR regular ever in the Indianapolis 500, finishing fourth in 1970 and capturing the Rookie of the Year title at the world-famous Brickyard. Neil Bonnet earned his entry into the gang in the early 70s, winning consecutive Birmingham track championships driving cars owned by Bobby Allison. Donnie was the first of the original gang to feel a sting of fate. After nearly winning the 1979 Daytona 500, his career appeared to be on solid footing with 10 wins. but a grinding crash at Charlotte in 1981 produced severe internal and head injuries that prematurely ended Donnie's competitive days at the wheel. In 1983, bad fortune relented and Bobby reached a long-sought goal, winning the NASCAR Winston Cup title. After five runner-up finishes in the battle for the national championship, his victory was one of the series' most popular ever. The next generation of the Alabama gang arrived in the NASCAR Winston Cup Series in 1987 with Bobby's oldest son, Davey. He was raised around the racetrack with all the proper tools to prepare him for greatness.
Davey was a pup. I was ASA racing, working in Hueytown, Alabama every now and then at Bobby's shop on my old ASA cars. And Davey was there and I'd send him for a wrench, send him for a ratchet, send him for a set of spark plugs, and he was a gopher. And then he got really good, traveled a lot of ASA races. Did good, raced with me a lot, and then really came a man of his own and followed in his father's footsteps by just paying a lot of attention to the cars, the springs, the shocks, the combinations, everything that it took to make that car win on Sunday.
When his father had a spectacular crash at their home track of Talladega, Davey kept his composure to capture his first career win in just his 14th start on his way to the Rookie of the Year title. While 1988 started with such promise for the Allisons at Daytona with a 1-2 finish, Neil Bonnett kept the gang's momentum going, capturing the next two events at Richmond and Rockingham. No one knew at the time, but it would be Bobby and Neil's last trips to Victory Lane as drivers, as one of the grimmest tales in American sports history would start to unfold. 4 months after the Daytona triumph, Bobby would be gravely injured in a crash at Pocono. It would rob him of one of life's most precious possessions.
Probably the greatest event that could have ever happened to a person, I can't remember. You know, I won the Daytona 500 at age 50, and the best young man in racing was second behind me, and that was my son Davey. And then when I was injured later that year, the memory loss that I had has taken that completely away. I know it happened. I can look at pictures, I can read books, I can even look at videotapes, but I can't remember any piece of it myself. And so I say, okay, I accept that.
Bobby faced years of physical rehabilitation following his Pocono crash, but with the support of his wife and family, he survived. But the gang was about to face even more tribulation. In the spring of 1990, Neil Bonnett would suffer a head injury, a crash at Darlington that appeared to end his career. Then in August of 1992, Bobby would lose his youngest son, Clifford, in a NASCAR Busch Grand National Series practice crash at Michigan. The gloom for the Alabama gang was deep. If they only knew what lay ahead. In the summer of 1993, the sun was burning a little brighter for the Alabama gang. Bobby Allison returned to the cockpit 5 years to the day after his Pocono crash to compete in the Fast Masters Championship. Davey was on hand to watch his dad compete and was his biggest fan.
What'd you think of the old man's performance tonight?
Well, I'll tell you, he's still my hero. I think he did a great job, and it was real exciting. He recovered real good from the incident at the start of the road course event and went on to finish third. And, you know, to have two third-place finishes tonight's a pretty outstanding accomplishment, too.
With Bobby's successful return, the focus returned to Davey, who had developed into one of NASCAR Winston Cup Racing's biggest stars. Just weeks following Bobby's comeback, Davey had picked up senior Alabama gang member Red Farmer in his helicopter for a quick trip to the Talladega Super Speedway to visit with Neil Bonnett, who was testing in anticipation to his return to racing. The trip ended in tragedy. The copter crashed, taking Davey's life and seriously injuring Red. With the racing world mourning its loss, Donnie Allison paid tribute to his nephew with a farewell lap that broke a nation's heart.
Hardest lap I ever made in my life in a race car was the Talladega in that 28 car. I could, all the way around that day, I could think of Davey and the way he used to talk. Uncle Donnie, I'm gonna make it. And he did, and nobody really will ever know how good the kid could have really been. But it was the hardest lap I ever made in my life.
Neil Bonnett would make his comeback that day, but the following February, he would lose his life in a practice accident at the Daytona International Speedway. It was another numbing occurrence in a storm of tragedies for the proud Alabama gang. But the NASCAR family stood solid in a moving tribute to Neil. With all those events still weighing heavily, Bobby soldiered on as owner of his Winston Cup team. Eventually, sponsor failures and terrible racing luck forced Bobby to disband his team and sell most of his possessions to meet his creditors' demands. His marriage of more than 30 years with his best friend in life, Judy, ended in divorce.
Bobby Allison is such a special person who's also set great example to all of us. We've all read about Job. Bobby is the modern day Job. Believe me, the guy, what he's been through has been unbelievable. I think he's an example to so many people today. When you start having a bad day, you think about Bobby Allison, and you're not having a bad day.
He's given all you can give to a sport he loved, and Donnie and the whole family, the Alabama gang. I mean, what a tough deal. And I suppose more people spent more hours praying for Bobby Allison than any other racer I ever met. And I go in that same category because he's my hero.
In April of 1998, Davey will join his father in the International Motorsports Hall of Fame founded by Bill France Sr. and where Bobby was so emotionally inducted in 1993. For Bobby, the resolve to continue comes from a life that was built on a deep belief in family values and knowing he and the Alabama gang are loved by millions.
I have to say that I made lots and lots of friends along the way, and that was one of the things that was really special to me. You know, the people, no matter if we were in Alabama or Florida or the Carolinas or up north somewhere or out west somewhere, the people that just really wanted to let me know that they appreciated the effort that I had put into it and that we had put into it, and that they enjoyed what we were doing and they wanted to see me do well.
In the NASCAR family, there are many great rivalries and heated debate about who is the best. You must look no further than the top two winners in the all-time history of the sport to find the greatest rivalry and greatest finish ever. No doubt, Richard Petty is the king, but no one has come closer to matching him in head-to-head competition than David Pearson. 63 times in NASCAR Winston Cup history, Petty and Pearson finished 1-2. Petty won 31 times, but Pearson won 32.
David Pearson never wanted to be in anyone's shadow. David Pearson could not stand losing.
Their greatest battle came in NASCAR's biggest race, the Daytona 500. As the 76th season opened, Petty and Pearson were at the peak of their careers. Petty was coming off his sixth championship. Pearson had a string of success with the Wood Brothers in which he had won 26 Super Speedway races in the past four seasons. With a live national television audience tuned to ABC, the stage was set.
Everybody is standing here at the Daytona International Speedway. Look at David Pearson. He has moved closer. Can he do it?
He's going to pull out now. He's going to try for the
top. I don't know. He's down on the inside. He's got the lead, but there's a car ahead of him. There is a slower car ahead of him. And Richard Petty and Pearson go high. Pearson now has the lead. Petty tries to go back down on the inside. As they come out of the fourth turn, they only have about 750 yards to go.
Oh!
It's an excellent straightaway. They did hit. Petty smashes into the wall. Will he come across the start-finish line? He's going to win the race. He's going to win it spinning as he, I believe, will take the checkered flag. No, he did not make it. He is less than 100 yards from it. Here comes Pearson. Pearson is going to try to make it across the finish line. Petty has his car going. Pearson's going to win it. Oh, fast angle. He wins the race.
What the finish for a Borgen. I've never seen anything like that.
It's unbelievable.
When Chris Economaki reached Petty's crashed car in the tri-oval grass, it was a chaotic scene.
He looks all right. What happened?
make the camera on the road, Richard.
They went around me and even had to let off, and I drove on in under him when I did. The front end broke loose and got him sideways.
Okay, Richard Petty walking away. Petty is all right physically. He didn't even seem mad, Bill.
Just a few moments later, when Chris arrived in Victory Lane, he found Pearson to be as cool and composed as ever.
Hey, David, what, you guys are really in show business. What a finish. What actually happened up there?
Well, Chris, I drove by. I'm going down the back stretch, and naturally, I guess if his car got to pushing or something, he just pushed right on up into me and naturally hit me and spun me around. And
Well, you know, I talked with Richard. He didn't sound mad at all or upset. He just explained it much like you did. There's no hard feelings here, is there?
No, because I really don't think he meant to do it. I really don't. Because, of course, you know, he was trying to win a race just like I was.
With their battles behind them, the mutual respect between the sport's all-time winners is still evident.
That was another one of the incidents that was a bad incident from my standpoint, and probably Pearson's too, but he went up winning. But it was good for racing because everybody wanted to see it again, everybody wanted to know about it, everybody wanted to know what happened. So it wasn't a deal where on Monday it said Pearson wins and Petty runs second. It kept it in the paper for a lot of different times, and we've been hashing around for all these years, so it had to be a big deal, and it really was a big plus for Winston Cup racing.
Richard, I guess, is one of the closest friends I got, as far as that goes. I hope he is, anyway. But no, we didn't fuss about it. As far as I know, I don't reckon we've ever fussed about anything.
The Petty-Pearson rivalry is the standard against which all others will be measured. They handled the spotlight with class, determination, and a real sense of the importance of their responsibility to the sport and its fans. And their family heritage continues today with their sons. Kyle Petty is an 8-time winner in NASCAR and Winston Cup racing. Larry Pearson is a 2-time NASCAR Busch Series champion, while his brothers Ricky and Eddie are race-winning mechanics. Now, with over 6 million fans in attendance in 1997, the NASCAR Winston Cup Series is the most popular form of American motorsports. But still, it is bigger than that. With over 2,200 events at 125 tracks in 38 states, there are 12 divisions that range from the Featherlight Modified Tour in the Northeast along the Atlantic Seaboard to the Winston West Series on the Pacific. NASCAR.com is one of the most visited sites of all on the World Wide Web. NASCAR cafes, NASCAR Thunder retailers, as well as Daytona USA are continuing to build upon the value of the NASCAR name that was born at the Streamline Hotel in 1947. What then is the NASCAR story?
No matter where we go in life, we need to know, where did we start? Where did we come from?
The NASCAR story is a story that took a down-at-the-heels sport, a bunch of hot rodders trying to kill themselves.
Smashing each other all over the place and having Big Bill France come in and say, okay, guys, we've got to have some rules. Let's get this thing straightened out.
It's not about a man with a dream. Dream would be the wrong word to put on Bill Sr.'s efforts in creating NASCAR, but he did have vision.
Well, Bill France Sr. Really saw that the American automobile had a great attraction to a wide variety of people.
I don't think anybody else in the world could have done it but Bill France Sr.
The reality of the France family dream is that NASCAR's first 50 years reflects phenomenal growth.
The 50-year story is almost a microcosm of almost any American success story.
And to see the efforts that you've put in all these years, like I say, blood, sweat, and tears, lean years, hard years.
It is the epitome of American capitalism.
It's a body that's entertaining and has thousands and thousands and thousands, or I should say millions and millions and millions of fans.
Because you just think all the companies that change CEOs and their stock goes up and their stock goes down and they're doing good and they're doing bad. This thing has been on a steady incline for a long, long time.
To me, the innovation in NASCAR, the commitment, the emotion, the fans, it
just outstanding. It's a great American sport.
It really makes you feel good that you're a part of it, and you've been a part of it since it began.
NASCAR is, I guess, the great American dream.
While the NASCAR and Winston Cup Series remains at the pinnacle for the sanctioning body, its reach is much deeper.
It's made up of a lot of good people.
We would just happen to be the right people at the right time with the right situation to grow with NASCAR.
And every business in the world operates on people, having the right people at the right place at the right time.
Bill France has always found people who can stand up and take the heat and make the decisions, and everybody that's watching or is a fan says, hey, those guys are fair.
Here are the rules as they are prescribed, but if you do all these things and you come to the racetrack and your car qualifies, you could be the next Hendrick team.
Now mainstream in the business and sporting world, the heart and soul of NASCAR remains true to what is still its defining moment, the moment when the green flag drops.
I love to watch a stock car.
When I was running, I said there ain't no way they can get the cars any closer than they are now.
It's a close bumper-to-bumper racing. It's the drafting.
What we do on Sunday will never change.
It's a 3-4 wide type of racing on a great super speedway that you will never see anywhere else.
I never dreamed I'd be good enough to race NASCAR.
It's an immense, wonderful feeling.
And my feelings the first NASCAR race I did was, I can't believe this, that I'm racing with Richard Petty.
And I still love to watch a car race and watch that drama unfold.
And when that baby's thundering halfway through the race and she's looking good, and then you look up and you got a half a lap lead on the field and there's five laps to go.
You can imagine what goes on in your head. The voice in my head was saying, I can't believe I just beat Bobby Allison.
And then that checkered flag's waving, that's what it's all about.
NASCAR racing is exciting, it's drama, it's action, it's safe, it's fun, it's a great sport.
If you haven't heard about NASCAR Winston Cup racing, you'll be hearing a lot about it very soon.
Only in America. Bill France left Washington, D.C., went to Daytona Beach, had a dream of starting this national racing organization, and he started it and had visions of what it could become when he built Daytona and Talladega, and it came true.
In the first 50 years of NASCAR, the ultimate measure of success has been earning the season-long championship. One of Bill France Sr.'s original goals was to have the NASCAR champion be recognized as the national champion of stock car racing. Mission accomplished. These are the men who have earned the right to be called champion in NASCAR's elite series. The inaugural champion in 1949, Red Byron. 1950, Bill Rexford. Two-time champion, Herb Thomas. Two-time champion, Tim Flock. Three-time champion, Lee Petty. Two-time champion, Buck Baker. 1960, Rex White. Two-time champion, Ned Jarrett. Two-time champion, Joe Weatherly. Seven-time champion, Richard Petty. Three-time champion, David Pearson. 1970, Bobby Isaac. 1973, Benny Parsons. Three-time champion, Cale Yarborough. Seven-time champion, Dale Earnhardt. Three-time champion, Darrell Waltrip. 1983, Bobby Allison. Two-time champion, Terry Labonte. 1988, Bill Elliott. 1989, Rusty Wallace. 1992, Alan Kowicki. Two-time champion, Jeff Gordon. 1992, Alan Kowicki. While each champion, each competitor had his own unique style, his own motivation, there is one common thread that binds them all.
It's passion. I don't know how many people understand what passion means. I have a passion for racing. It's what excites me. It's what I dream about. It's what I think about. I look at a race car and I get excited. When it cranks up and the engine's roaring, I get really excited. And when I get in it and I go around the racetrack and it's running beautifully, it's running to perfection, and I'm driving like nobody's ever driven before, it's gratification. It's all the things to me that are important. Everything in my life, I mean, I love my family, my children, my wife, I love God, but that race car, it's like I put it on. It's like a coat. It's like my favorite sport coat. I put it on, and when I put it on, I look good. That's what it is to me.
From rogues on the beaches to kings of the road, the 50 NASCAR's first half century has been a remarkable ride. Here at the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History in Washington, I'm Bob Jenkins. For 17 years, I've had the privilege of being part of that journey as NASCAR Winston Cup anchor for ESPN and ABC. It is doubtful that even the most optimistic among NASCAR's founding members could have envisioned just how far their sport would be propelled. A small stock car association born of the need to find a way to ensure that promoters would pay the modest prize money they advertised, NASCAR now boasts of million-dollar purses and drivers whose celebrity transcends any region or event. But from this perspective, the challenge is not to quantify the magnitude of NASCAR's growth, but rather to gain some perspective on it. Former British statesman Benjamin Disraeli noted that life is too short to be little. Man is never so manly as when he feels deeply, acts boldly, and expresses himself with frankness and fervor. Well, there was nothing little about Big Bill France or his dream for American stock car racing. But a view 50 years long suggests the roots of NASCAR's phenomenal success may lie not so much in the magnitude of its founder's dream, but rather the commonness of his touch. NASCAR, perhaps more than any other American sport, has managed to maintain a strong bond between participant and spectator. It's a loyalty rooted firmly in America's unique passion for the automobile. NASCAR may now race in Las Vegas and Los Angeles, but still competes at Martinsville and Darlington. And drivers may have achieved rock star celebrity, but fans can still shake their hands and visit their race shops. And as Bill France deemed 50 years ago, the shiny decaled machines that each weekend fire allegiances still closely mirror their assembly line cousins. Ludwig von Beethoven once noted, "The barriers are not yet erected which can say to a genius, thus far, no further." Well, the gate is wide open as NASCAR steers into the next century. The foundation that William Henry Getty France built continues to be expertly piloted by his sons and grandchildren. And now there are millions of us along for the ride. On behalf of ESPN, we thank you for watching NASCAR The 50. We'll see you at the races.
The NASCAR story is a love letter etched with a pen that includes fingerprints from heroes and legends, as well as ordinary men and women performing extraordinary feats, all for the love of a sport and the pursuit of greatness. I'm Craig T. Nelson.
At last, my love has come along. My lonely days are over. And life is like a was wrapped up in clover. The night I looked at you, I found a dream that I could speak to, a dream that I can call my own. I found a thrill to press my cheek to, a thrill that
Continue watching for extended interviews with NASCAR legends that are included exclusively with this commemorative video.
Well, the first time I ever raced, I did it here at Greenville Pickin Speedway. Bill France Sr. come to Greenville to promote a race. Never been to a race, never saw one, didn't know what the red flag meant or anything. So I raced out there that day, and that just set it on fire. So I've been at it ever since. So Bill France went to Florida, and he told everybody that about this driver, woman driver in Greenville, wild one. And so they started booking me, Bill and his other promoters, all across country. So I got in it that way, but they had to stop me off of the speedway here because I didn't know what a checker flag meant. I saw it, and we didn't have no garage. You just pulled off the side of the speedway, you know, and stopped. But somebody thought about getting, all they told me, if you have see a red flag, stop. So I didn't see one, and I kept going. They finally got out there. I wonder where they all went to. I could see the cars over there. And I was the only one out there still flying, and they had to finally give me a red flag, get me off the track. So that started it all.
Well, the fans loved him. I mean, you know, not only him, but I mean, he was, they called him the Crown Prince. I seen him come to the racetrack with a two-tone jacket on and pair of pants, one yellow leg and one brown leg and all this kind of stuff. But I mean, he was just a character. He was always playing pranks. And Bob Colvin, who's dead and gone, president of Darlington, he thought nobody was like that bunch, you know what I'm saying? And he's scared to death of a snake, and that damn Joe would get them old rubber snakes that long and put him on top of Colvin's head, and he was bald-headed, and he's standing in shake like this and sweat. Welburn was the same way. I mean, it's Pearson, and Joe delighted him, and he had the mongoose, the tail in the box, and he'd throw that thing on everybody. I'm telling you, he was always up to some kind of mess, and was till the day he got killed in Riverside. And he was one of my best friends, and that weekend that he went to Riverside and got killed, he called me 5 times to Riverside begging me to come out there. I said, Joe, I got too much to do. I ain't got time to come out. We said, come on, you can fly back Saturday and come back with me Sunday. And I never will forget it, but 11:30 Sunday night, I'm riding down Virginia Beach Boulevard. I've been off playing poker, and I had the radio on. Joe Weatherly killed in an accident in Riverside. I like to turn it, 64 GTO I had. I like to turn the thing over. Unbelievable. because I'd have bet money that Joe Welly would never got killed in a race car, and I'd have bet money that Turner would never got killed flying an airplane, and both of them did.
You know, there's been a lot of times in auto racing that you could have been seriously injured or even killed, you know, because a lot of things have happened and will happen if you're going to be in the, have auto racing as a career. In 1971, I blew an engine going down the straightaway, the back straightaway at Charlotte, backstretch. And I thought I had slowed the car down enough, but when I got to turn three, the tires got in the oil and did a slow half spin up the racetrack. Didn't hit the wall, but when I got to the banking, the brakes would not hold the car on the banking. It's slowly going down the banking. And I looked up out of the corner, I looked up out the driver's door, because I'm sitting facing traffic. I looked out of the driver's door and Jim Vandiver is coming straight at me. And he looked like he was running 300 miles an hour. I mean, honest to God, he looked like he was running faster than the pole speed. He was flying. And I just knew that I was a goner. I mean, I had this sick feeling in my stomach and I just closed my eyes because, it's over. You know, they talk about you, things flash through your mind. Nothing flashed through my mind other than the fact that this is it. And he missed me. I don't have a clue how he did it, but he missed me. Every time I see Jim Vandiver and I introduce him to people today, I say this, you know, if I were to introduce him to you, I would say, this is Jim Vandiver, the best race car driver in the world, because he missed me that day. But the ironic thing, ARCA was having a race that day at Texas World Speedway. And in the couple of years that I ran ARCA, there was a fellow from Austin, Texas named Louis Wusterhausen that ended up being a very good friend of ours, me and my crew. And my crew, he was by himself, would drive to the racetrack by himself. My crew would help him unload his car, and what have you. But Louis was in that race that day. And going in turn three at Texas World Speedway. And if we were to really sit down with a clock and figure it out, it had to be within seconds of the same time. He's going in turn three, something happened, he spins up the racetrack, slow spin, starts down the racetrack, a car hits Louis in the door and kills him. And I always said that Louis took the shot that was intended for me. Because there's no way Vandiver's going to miss me, and at that same, almost same instant, Louis Wusterhausen is getting killed in Texas. Very ironic.
It was about 1967. We had a half-mile paved track, and we used to ask some of the Grand National or Winston Cup stars like Bobby Allison and others to come in and run with the regulars on those evenings. And that particular night, Buddy Baker was there. If you have to remember, racing has come a long way now. we had one safety vehicle, which was a hearse. And in that hearse, we had two people, plus we had a fire extinguisher, and we had a bag of oil dry. And for 2 years, we never used anything. Well, this particular event, we had just built the concrete wall around the track. We didn't have a wall around the track before that. So we built the concrete wall, and Buddy was leading the race from about 30 laps into the race. He went straight into the wall in turn one, and broke the wall and went all the way down into two. And the first thought I had is, oh my gosh, my new wall. And then I said, oh geez, Buddy, I bet he's hurt. So I used to drive the pace car and we ran down there in the pace car and he was sitting outside the car. So I called this hearse to come over and I said, Buddy, you got to go to the hospital and get checked. He says, I'm fine, Don. I said, no, you need to really do this. I said, I saw how hard you broke the wall. The car is in shambles. So he said, okay. So they drove up, first case they ever had, and they had this gurney that extended, so they laid him down on the gurney and they collapsed the wheels and put him in the back of the hearse. And they were excited because it was their first experience at something like this. And so we got the field going and they started running down that back straight really quick. And about the time they got to turn two, they had forgot to chalk the wheels on the gurney. And the gurney and Buddy Baker rolled out back on the apron, and I came. I was coming off the second turn with the cars, and I saw. I didn't know what it was first, but I saw something, and I saw hands like this waving, and I said, "My gosh, that's Buddy Baker coming our way." So we went to the right, as close to the wall as we could. We stopped the race at that point. And we went up and apologized to Buddy, and Buddy said, "Don, please let me," and he was strapped in, you see, said, "Please let me out of this." I said, "You got to go to the hospital." He said, "Well, let me ride in the cab with these other guys." So I said, "Okay." So he got in the cab and started riding. It was 15 miles to the hospital, and I had called ahead and told him that get ready. We had Buddy Baker coming. There was one red light, and they were going about 100 miles an hour, and they got to this red light, and their brakes didn't work. So there was a drive-in on the corner, one of these old-fashioned drive-ins. They went around beside the round, made a turn, went behind the drive-in, hit about six or eight garbage cans to scuff off some speed, I guess. And then they continued on down, and they got to the hospital, and they waiting there with a wheelchair for Buddy. And so they asked him, "Buddy, you want us to wait for you?" And he said, "No, guys, you go back to the racetrack. I'll hitchhike back." So, and that is the absolute truth. And if you can just tell how far racing has come. Of course, that was their last trip. After that, we had fire engines and safety vehicles. And we learned. I learned a great deal by that incident. And everybody enjoys it now, but I was very embarrassed by it, to tell you the truth.
Buddy and I went down to fish with Tiny at Santee Cooper one time. It was in August, real hot. And we're going out the little canal from Tiny's fish camp out to the main body of water. There's a small alligator laying on the bank, probably 2.5 feet, 3 feet long. And Buddy Baker does not like anything without shoulders that crawls. And he shivered, and he says, "My goodness, I didn't know there were alligators in Santee Cooper Reservoir." And Tiny saw right away the possibilities of another great joke. And he said, "Oh man, we've got man-eaters in here, 14 feet long." But he said, "Oh wow, I didn't know that." So we go on out. The fish aren't schooling. They're not going to school late afternoon. It's very hot. The lake is like a mirror, and Buddy starts complaining about the heat. And Tiny says, "Well, why don't you strip down to your skivvies and take a dip and cool off?" So, to my great surprise, Buddy goes over the side of the boat. Well, I turn to say to Tiny, "I can't believe he did that." Well, Tiny's gone. And Buddy comes up, shakes his head, starts talking about how great the water feels. And there's this horrified scream. His eyes get this big, and he goes underwater. And he comes up screaming for me, yelling for me to throw him a rope. And under he goes again. And then he comes up, and Tiny is beside him, just choking in laughter. Tiny swam under the boat, reached up from below, and took Buddy, hold of Buddy in a very delicate place, shall we say, and pulls. And I said, "Buddy, why didn't you just swim to the boat?" And he says, "Are you crazy? When you think an alligator has a hold of your manhood, you go where the alligator wants to go."
We were coming home from race one time, and Tiny found a wino, this man in a ditch. And he picked the guy up and took him home with us, and he nursed him back to health. He bathed him, fed him. He took care of this man for about 3 or 4 days. And when the man got well enough, Tiny says, "Can you drive?" And the guy said, "Yes." And he says, "Will you go to town and make a deposit for me?" And the man said, "Sure." And after he leaves, I'm questioning Tiny about this decision. I said, "Tiny, you don't even know this man, and how do you know he'll come back?" And he said, "Well, he said he would. You know, he said he'll come back. No big deal. He'll be back." And the man did come back, and he actually stayed with us about 4 years, and his name is Charlie. That's all I know. And you could be at the fish camp, we'd cook and serve out of bowls and pass the bowl around family style. You may be seated on one side by president of a corporation, and on the other side would be Tiny's wino, Charlie. He made no difference at all in people. You know, and he always told me that everybody did deserved a place they could call home. He was very, he was a very much a people person, but he was very much treated all people the same.